Rolling Stone. I'm sorry, Jan's in a meeting. May I take a message?
Now that would be news and opinion plus capital chatter and the wizard, such as the wizard may be. Then the issue after with bedfellows. The issue after is me. Bedfellows, skiing, okay? And then two political pieces.
Wait a minute.
Bedfellows is
what, 20,000 words?
I know.
Well, how long is
running in one session?
What?
Today.
Oh, we'll go out and sell. Everybody have to hit the streets and sell some ads. Maybe Abe.
Everybody will have to hit the streets. What
are we going to have for music then?
I don't know about music because Abe is not here. Abe is out working on the tubes right now.
What kind of show are you going to do?
Tomorrow we're going to do, as usual, an extravaganza. A show that will probably cost us more than we make.
And now please welcome live on stage and live on video, A&M recording artist, The Two.
What do you want from life? To kidnap an heiress or threaten her with a knife? Miss, baby, got no plan.
As we sit here, you're Fee Waybill. But who will you be tomorrow night?
Who will I be? Well, gosh. Well, I think we're going to be changing the set a little bit tomorrow. We're going to do the U.S. citizen. One of my new characters is the typical American, middle American. Are you writing all this down?
Sure.
Citizen.
Yes. Test.
That's one of our new ones. And we're going to do all of our great numbers, Bondo Bondage. We're going to do White Punks on Dope with Quaalude. And we're going to do Rock and Roll Hospital, I hope. A lot of places we can't do Rock and Roll Hospital. It's a real controversial number because of the chainsaw.
What happened? So you can't get a work permit to use the chainsaw?
No, if the place serves drink or food, for some reason you can't have a flammable liquid, which like gas, in the chainsaw. And so they freak out and they won't let us do it. But we're going to do it anyway, I imagine. We usually do it anyway. And by the time they get the fire marshal there, we pack up.
You're gone.
And we're gone to the next city.
So you're going to change. What kind of clothes does middle American wear? What kind of costume?
He wears your typical American suit, three-piece suit, two-piece suit, actually. Most of them can't afford the vest.
But then you're going to run from that into the bondage outfit.
No, that'll probably go into the revolutionary dancer outfit.
Malaguena set?
Malaguena.
How about saying like Valley High? Like, what do you wear for that?
Tom Jones outfit secretly underneath my tuxedo I wear there. My German scientist attire. All the German scientists are wearing this year. I wear that. And then I wear the Tom Jones blousy English long sleeve white
That's for
shirt.
The big, it's not unusual production number.
Exactly. The girls don't wear hardly anything now. We've gone back. See, we're regressing down to scantier outfits. We put on, the girls used to not wear hardly anything, and then when we went on the tour all across the East Coast and Canada, we went to Toronto. And that was another place we couldn't do it in Toronto. They didn't want to show any bare flesh. Not too much flesh, anyway. Anyway, the girls started wearing more because in such places as Cleveland, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, you know, they weren't ready for that expose.
I could run away to Spain, get tired again. I could run off to Jamaica if this bondage I could break up.
I want to go back a little to the mechanisms of the show. And, you know, if you could describe, like, the various costumes that you wear, and if you could go through what might be an average set, whether it's a set you do tomorrow or not.
To single out any costume, I think, and dwell on one particular point might be a great mistake. On the other hand, it might not. It's real tube show is real complicated and usually very dirty. The costumes are very dirty because we can't afford to get them cleaned. All the girls have real fancy rhinestone outfits, and they always have to be cleaned.
And what are their big numbers that they show up for?
They're in the funky revolution number. There's a revolutionary, political, very, very good dance choreographed by our choreographer, Kenny Ortega. They all have a bunch of fatigue outfits, right? And then I do the Malagueño with my really nicely pressed fatigue outfit with an ascot and a silver gun and patent leather shoes and everything. It's very crisp, you see. The leader never actually gets out to the field, ever.
Right.
He just gives a lot of orders. And then they appear in the Tom Jones number with their real scanty outfits. And as I said, Tom wears his tight-fitting pants and blousy shirt and usually gets presents from the audience, from girls in the audience, all underwear and stuff like that, all kinds of things.
And then there's White Punks.
Then the White Punks on dope. Quaalude comes out with his 18-inch platform Mylar shoes and the silver LeMay jumpsuit with rhinestones. We have new suits with rhinestones now, glittering all over in big wig. And actually, he's pretty good looking. He's one of my favorite characters.
I don't want to treat the thing like it's a big special issue. That's how it was conceived, but I want to treat it as a section, even though it will be a whole bunch of stuff.
But
the people's expectations are not going to be that high about it, and then they're going to really like it vis-a-vis the other person.
Yeah, I understand exactly. And in fact, that's right. But that's going to make it very difficult for us. Go ahead. To actually.
Yeah. When's the Bill Graham thing coming out?
There are very few giants that don't work. Bob Dylan doesn't work. The Beatles, of course, don't work. But those that work, every single one, as far as I know, is visiting the United States in the year 7, 1976, whether it's because of the bicentennial or because they see something and aren't aware of it, all the others see it also. I mean, I've spoken to most of the managers and agents in the last month, and they all say, they're coming in too. I mean, every manager's saying, them too? When? The same time period? I mean, why? And why isn't everybody getting out of the way? Because Moses is coming. And from Elton John to the Stones to Led Zeppelin to the Who to you name it, they're all coming. But we're faced with the realities that many, many of these artists don't consider performing their life. And the less they can perform at a higher price so that they can go and do the things that they enjoy to do, which if it's sailing their boat or playing with their 16-track or playing with their family, we're not talking about guys who are 30, 32, 35, mm-hmm. 40, one kid, more kids, lifestyles beyond the music, and they are able to take the earnings from their music and do the things they enjoy, and they're no different than you and I. There was a time when I wanted to spend 20 hours a day at the Fillmore. That was my life. It is no longer my life. Well, it's no longer Peter Townsend's life, or it's no longer Jimmy Page's life. So that if they can come and do 12 summer dates and make six figures a date, it's better than doing 54 dates like the Stones did 3 years ago at indoor facilities where they made less and spent more time performing. They're not Sophie Tucker, and they're not Milton Berle, they're not Sammy Davis Jr., who need that, because it's their life. Performing is not the life of the rock and roll star.
I don't want to talk about the San Francisco thing. Why? We're going to have a meeting tomorrow.
Oh,
and tomorrow we'll know what the take looks like. Tomorrow we'll have seen all the rest of the copies being pulled together.
Let me ask you one thing. Other than Iowa, do you want to run a whole news and opinion section?
Yeah,
or you just want to run Iowa?
Chatter in Iowa.
That's
and
all?
Do you think
you want to round out the section with something else?
Well, if we have the space, but we can decide that tomorrow.
Okay.
We can see tomorrow. I mean, you've got need a short, obviously.
Yeah.
Yeah. We got short. Do you want to run another feature other than?
No. That will be it. That will be our hard news feature.
You mean that Jack Scott may testify at the Patty Hearst trial?
Well, no, probably not. F. Lee Bailey has contacted him and asked him to testify for Patty's defense, but it doesn't look like Scott's going to cooperate with him.
Well, it seems to me that Scott would help the prosecution more than help Patty.
Well, yeah, he would, but there's no indication that he's going to.
But you said that Steve Weed might.
Steve Weed might be at the trial, yes, but
he would testify.
He'd be testifying for the defense.
And you talk about the state of mind before the kidnapping.
Right, and that's important to Bailey because it would indicate that Patty had no prior knowledge of her kidnapping.
That's one of the points I wanted to talk to you about. There's some new information down in Los Angeles that Patty may actually have known the SLA before the kidnapping. And there's also, I understand, some information that there may have been some police involvement in the SLA prior to the kidnapping.
Well, okay, I can go to Los Angeles, but I've heard that police theory before. I don't really believe it, but most of all, I don't think it's going to be brought up at the trial.
Yeah, but we should check it out anyway.
Yeah, we'll check it out. We have to cover all the bases, but the defense certainly isn't going to bring it up, and the prosecution's not likely to open a can of worms like that and involve the government. Why don't you take a rest?
Okay. Are you still convinced that Patty's going to be convicted?
Yeah, I am, because I think this case is going to be looked at by the jury as a test of the system, a lot like Watergate. If Patty gets off, it's going to look like any rich family can buy their way out of trouble.
Well, I don't know. But, I mean, the thing is, Bailey is a very effective lawyer with a jury, right? And
yeah, I'll grant you that.
And you've got to come back to the one thing that he's got to hammer at over and over again, that Patty Hearst started out as the victim of a brutal kidnapping. I don't know how the prosecution's going to get around that in the end, because all you need is a parent on that jury who is confronted with the possibility, what if this were my daughter? You know, could I say for sure how she would react, thrown into a closet, et cetera, et cetera. This is a terrifying thing that happened to her, and he's going to bring that out. And I think the prosecution, at best, is going to get a hung jury.
That's what
presumably, as I said 18 times, we'll decide tomorrow. The other covers are skiing after that, and you better put on skiing and bedfellows. Okay? We'll go into the next issue. And I'm hoping... it makes sense to me that we publish Mankiewicz's piece, if it's any good, on the Ford campaign staff, on the Reagan campaign staff, and how they're fighting each other. It'll come out the day of the new
Hampshire.
It'll be perfect, because it'll come out right at the same time as the primary. I think everybody's going to be very interested, because whatever happens, everybody's going to be extremely turned on to the Florida fight, and we'll be on sale during the whole time when people are thinking about the Florida and the campaign staff and everything. But Mankiewicz's analysis, and Frank is the perfect guy to do it, because they're... One of the staffs is the 68 Nixon campaign team, and one of them is the 72 Nixon campaign team, and they're fighting each other for Ford and Reagan. So that will be. And then we have Carl Hess's piece on the state of the Republican Party, i.e., program for a state funeral. You know, saying the Republican Party is dead. And it's a good piece, and we must get that thing
out. So this is 208 you're talking about?
That's 208. Okay. And then 209 is Dust. Okay, and Tony's picked the skiing cover already. It looks very good. I like it. You know, okay. Then 209 is going to be. Robert Redford and Dustin Hoffman on the cover.
Don't touch me. Hey, Ray. Hey, Sugar. Tell them who we are. Well, we're big rock singers. We got golden fingers. And we're loved everywhere we go.
That sounds like us.
We sing about beauty and we sing about truth at $10,000 a show.
Right.
We take all kind of
deals that give us all kind of thrills, but the thrill we've never known is the thrill that'll get you when you get your picture on the cover of the Rolling Stone.
Rolling Stone.
Wanna see my picture on the cover?
Stone.
Wanna buy 5 copies for my mother?
Yeah.
Wanna see my smiling face on the cover of the Rolling
Look,
Stone?
Look, I spoke to Yacht about this cover, and he says he wants sexy. Now, you know, a lot.
But who does it appeal to?
Look, if you don't think it's sexy, a lot of people do.
Katie, who embroiders on my jeans? I got my.
We have Elton John, his rumored hair transplant. Greg and Cher getting back together again. And of course, Bette Midler punching Paul Drew in the face. And now we have the great slick item.
Like the blow that'll get you when you get your picture on the cover of the Rolling Stone.
Rolling Stone.
Wanna see our pictures on the cover?
Stone.
Wanna buy 5 copies for our mother?
Yeah.
Wanna see my smiling face on the cover of the Rolling Stone?
It's hooked up to this anyway.
But how would you do this if it's black and white? You wanna just run
it
black and white?
Oh, I think you run it black and white.
As a cover?
Yeah. This is the last time we did a black and white cover was with.
Nick and Keith.
Nick and Keith, yeah. And it was hard, and this becomes a very special thing. This is an exclusive interview, which, you know, no one else has been able to get.
Right.
And black and white has, for us, certainly a lot of plans.
He's teaching us a better way. We got all the friends that money can buy, so we never have to be alone. And we keep getting richer, but we can't get our picture on the cover of the Rolling Stone.
Rolling Stone.
Wanna see my picture on the cover?
Stone.
Wanna buy 5 copies for my mother?
Stone.
Wanna see my smiling face on the cover of the Rolling Stone? On the cover of the Rolling
Stone.
Wanna see my picture on the cover?
We ain't on the cover,
wanna
baby.
Wanna buy 5 copies for my mother? Wanna see my smiling face on the cover of the Rolling Stone?
On the front, smiling, man. Oh, beautiful.
Enough of that.